I actually want to start with something you and I have talked about occasionally, and which has been a key issue ever since tax reform, which is what are corporations doing in terms of buybacks and/or investments? And you weigh in on this in terms of misperceptions surrounding corporate cash spending priorities and the economics of share repurchases. So what are the misperceptions and what did you find?
So the misperceptions are many, but let's take them sort of one at a time. First is a misperception that companies are suddenly increasing or shifting their decisions in terms of repurchasing stock. For 140 years, companies have been returning cash to shareholders. For the first 100 years,
dividends.
Back to 1880, was dividends. And then in terms of buybacks, that has increased over the last decade as a share. And one of the reasons for that is that the economy has been growing relatively slowly, and companies have been increasing the amount of leverage they have. And that increases the volatility of their earnings. As a result, buybacks give them more flexibility in terms of making those decisions of how to return cash to shareholders, dividends versus buybacks. So that's the first, give that perspective over time. Then you look at what's been happening in terms of the share of cash spent by corporations. Every single year, for 30 years, companies have directed more cash to investing for growth, capital spending, research and development dollars, spending on M&A, more investing for growth than returning cash to shareholders. Then you look at what is the growth as a result of the tax reform that took place last year. And what we find is the increase, and certainly there's been an increase in cash, money's been brought back onshore.
Right.
70% of the growth in buybacks came from just a few stocks, the top 10 stocks. And so you see Apple and Oracle and Qualcomm, and they had a lot of cash. They brought it back, and they've distributed more of that to shareholders, which they had then been reinvesting. And the last, and I think one of the most interesting misperceptions, is the idea that companies, managements, executives, are repurchasing stock as a way of enhancing their own compensation. But when you actually look at the management teams that have earnings per share as one of the metrics as part of their compensation plan, we find those companies actually buy back less, spend less dollars on repurchasing stock than companies where actually making that accretive share repurchase would have
right.
enhanced them. So the idea
we've made the point through the years, I think, that there are management teams that benefit from, as you say, are judged on EPS.
Are judged on EPS.
When you are reducing the flow, just so people understand, the EPS number goes up, obviously.
So they would normally, you would assume that if they were really looking to enhance their own
right.
Best interest from a financial point of view, would choose to buy back more stock. We don't find that.
All of it says what? Though about the bigger issue, which is capital spending and whether or not it has increased appreciably otherwise from what it otherwise would have been without tax reform.
Well, it's difficult to say from the counterfactual, but what we do find certainly is as profits have been repatriated, some of that has gone to investing for growth, some of that has gone to return cash to shareholders, dividends and buybacks. And the interesting thing is that it was so chunky, it was so concentrated in a relatively few number of stocks. In terms of that increase, the amount of increase came
In the buybacks,
right. But more companies, they're investing a lot for cash. And so you think about, we just had the 10th anniversary of the bull market.
Yes.
And so if we go back over 10 years, 75% of the rise in the market comes from earnings growth. The level of profits are higher. About 20% comes from a PE multiple expansion. And so we think about where is the compass directing us towards forecasting growth in earnings. And there's modest growth in earnings because the economy is decelerating. And one of the things from a tactical point of view is that the earnings recession, we're likely to have a negative earnings growth year over year in the first quarter. We'll get those results somewhere between the middle of April, middle of May, kind of that's the time of reporting. That, in my view, puts some headwinds in terms of the market moving a lot higher. We're at 2,800 right now. As we look further out in the year, the idea of the economy kind of continuing to grow would suggest to us that you get earnings sort of improving year over year growth, and that would lead to a higher market and a target at the end of the year of around 3,000 for the S&P 500. So it's basically a flat overall market near term and then rising later in the year. And that's how we think about it.
There seems to be a conundrum, though. I mean, Morgan Stanley had this really interesting note out over the weekend. I don't know if you caught that at all, but they're basically saying that in this environment, there's upward wage pressures, but there's very little overall inflation. And so when you have this rising cost here, in addition to any other rises in costs, commodities, et cetera, but you have very little ability to raise price, you have this conundrum for corporations where their profit margins get eroded. It's got to come from somewhere. So how do you view that?
So the way I view that is a couple ways. Mm-hmm. From a societal point of view, it's a good thing that you have wage inflation. From an investing point of view, that represents potential headwind on margins for some companies. And so as a strategy, for a long time, we've been focusing on companies where labor, wage costs are a relatively small share of their revenues. And so put that in some context. Typical company in the United States, around 13% of its sales is consumed by its labor budget. That's a distribution. Some companies are 5%, some companies are 25%. And so as a portfolio manager, we want to focus on and recommend to portfolio managers focus on companies where labor is a relatively small share, because they will have less headwinds from their margins. So you look at a company like Google's example of that, PayPal's example, companies where they're strong revenue growth, but it's less of a risk in terms of their margin headwind. So that's how I would combat that, and that's how we recommend, you know, clients address that as a headwind. It's absolutely an issue, and you see wage inflation as unemployment rates remains below 4%.